I believe defending a championship is way harder than becoming a champion. There's always more pressure defending, keeping that title that you work hard to get. Anyone, whoever wants to become champion, they just want to destroy you. They want to take what's yours. And with a guy like Jake Biel, he just wants to destroy you. But he would always nag and put you down. He would step on you and step on you.
Amigo!
Crush you down and just make you feel this big. Being the smallest superstar in that ring, facing giants in a world of giants, that was my fuel to overcome every time I stepped into the ring with him. I had finally reached the pinnacle of WWE by winning the World Heavyweight Championship at WrestleMania in honor of my good friend, Eddie Guerrero. As a World Heavyweight Champion, I knew I had a target on my back and would face some of my toughest opponents, including John Bradshaw Layfield. JBL always made it very easy to get motivated for a match. His loud mouth, the constant mockery, and his knack for crossing the line to make things personal. He didn't think I was a real champion. He thought I'd just be a stepping stone to his reign as a dual champion. Went into Judgment Day, ready to show him that all his bluster and power wasn't enough to stop Rey Mysterio.
Face. 2.
rebound.
Champion! The big red machine Kane had his sight set on eliminating me from WWE in 2008. The monstrous 7-foot-tall behemoth took pleasure in mocking my pain and misery. Kane thought he could use his mind games to break me, but I wasn't gonna let that happen. It's tough keeping your head in the game when facing someone so sick and sadistic. But at Cyber Sunday, where the WWE Universe would choose our match stipulation, the fans chose no holds barred. I didn't know what type of strategy I was going to bring to the table that night. My technique has always been aerial maneuvers. Was I going to be able to get away with it at a no holds barred match? I made a promise to myself that I wasn't going to show fear. How do I take the big man down? Hit him with whatever I got. I was gonna meet him head on, regardless of the match type, and show him that you can't break the estadio.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Kane and a Hall of Famer. I mean, I have to admit, Kane is special, but an evil special. When I became Intercontinental Champion, I was honored to hold the title with such a vast legacy of greatness. I was excited to face new challengers as the landscape was evolving. A brash newcomer named Dolph Ziggler thought he had me figured out and brushed me to the side. My point of view of Dolph Ziggler coming in, I had the utmost respect for him. He was very exciting to watch. He had a style, but with a new spike to it, a new feel to it. I knew Dolph was hungry coming into this match, and he was one of the up-and-coming superstars. But there's a mistake that he made that you never make in this business. Dolph felt like he was already the Intercontinental Champion before our match had even started. So I made sure to teach him a very valuable lesson at the biggest party of the summer. At SummerSlam, Dolph's arrogance was going to be his downfall if I had my way. You know, that meant some more high-risk lucha libre, too. Thank you.
Mario.
RTX.
Against hungry competitors like Dolph Ziggler. That bragging rights for the world heavyweight title was every man for himself. I would have thought that Batista would have known that walking into that match.
Ray, I'm gonna rip your head off.
I'm no stranger to betrayal. Throughout my career, I had people that I thought were friends end up turning their backs on me. But this one, for some reason, hit a very soft spot. I couldn't make sense of what had gone down.
You're supposed to be my friend! Hey.
If I would have known that this was gonna interfere in our friendship, I would have never have done what I did.
We had gone through so much together, and I just couldn't believe how quickly he could throw that all away.
I'm not thinking about what we've been through. I'm not thinking about you. I'm thinking about me.
After weeks of verbal and physical assaults, I knew that we could never go back to the way things were. I wanted to make him feel the same way I did, to return that feeling to him. And the best way I could think to do that was to beat him on SmackDown and get the number one contender spot that Batista felt belonged to him. Batista's game plan from the get-go was gonna be to manhandle me. So I just looked to use the momentum to my favor. I mean, my hope was to be wherever his fists and boots were not. And then before I knew it, I was in the worst possible spot I could ever be in. Just gotta start going crazy, doing whatever I can to get free. Luckily for me, I was close to the ropes, or that would have been a really short night for me. Batista can pretty much hurt you with simple stuff, like clotheslines or spears. I literally have to hurl myself at you from tall heights to get that same effect. It definitely did the trick.
Ah!
was going out on my sword, you know? If I had any breath left, I was fighting him. I couldn't give up. Like we all do at points, he got a little careless, a little sloppy, and I made him pay. I wanted to get revenge on him, but I knew the best way to do that was winning the match and taking the world championship opportunity from him. Batista just wanted to hurt me, and his forgetting the gold made it possible for me to get that win. I hated having to fight him. But, hey, you gotta do what you gotta do once that bell rings. Dealing with Batista, I felt like I was at the top of my career. I was a number one contender.
Uh-oh.
The Undertaker is unlike any other opponent.
Rey Mysterio, your courage unquestionable, but make no mistake about it, I will show you no mercy.
I went into the 2010 Royal Rumble fully believing in myself, confident I could defeat him.
At the Royal,
I knew I had the speed advantage, and that if I could maybe take out a leg or catch him with something unexpected, I had a chance. It's not just the size of the dog in the fight, but the size of the fight in the dog, right? Well, this dog had just found himself in the yard of the top dog, the Phenom. It would take everything I had to avoid ending the night resting in peace. human. And I knew if I just kept at it, I could win this match and become world heavyweight champion again. I just had to get back to my feet. It wouldn't be the last time we compete, but it's one of my favorite matches, even if it didn't go my way that night. Hasta la. With the WWE Championship controversially vacated in the summer of 2011, I fought and clawed to the finals of the WWE title tournament with my opponent, The Miz. had to face three different opponents to get to the top of the tournament. Dolph Ziggler, R-Truth, and then The Miz. I hate The Miz inside that ring, because he's very dangerous. He'll do anything to win. Maybe we weren't in the middle of a huge personal rivalry, but there was no chance I was going to let The Miz stand in my way of finally winning the WWE Championship. With an opponent as tricky as he is, I had to be ready for anything. Every time you face him, you just don't know what he's gonna come up with to try to steal one from you, which can make the whole pace of the match feel fast and chaotic. But I thrive in that environment, and that night, I was going to use every bit of my experience to get that victory. A lot of people underestimate Miz's mental approach. But he was cutting me off at every turn in this match. He wasn't joking around. Miz definitely came looking to prove his last reign wasn't a fluke. He was ready for everything early on and had me rocked. Maybe I had come in taking Miz a little lightly. But I can tell you, after I kicked out here, I understood that I was going to be in a dogfight. Despite his team saying otherwise, on this night, he had not come out to play. just needed something to bite a minute because Miz was coming strong. Thankfully, the ring post was right there when I needed it. When he kicked out, and I truly think I lost my focus there for a minute. Miz took advantage when I let frustration take over for a second, and that DDT that he hit me with had me seeing stars. Maybe he didn't get the pin there, I don't know, but if I made another mistake like that, I was gonna pay. Miz would be leaving the arena with his second WWE Championship. was truly fortunate that Miz, probably a little impatient there, grabbed me when I was so close to the ropes. If I can't get my hand on the ropes, he probably ends this match right there. A costly mistake on his part. Miz left me hanging there a bit too long. By the time he was charging, I saw him clearly and basically played possum. After the match we had, I didn't want to get ahead of myself. But man, when I saw him hit those ropes, I knew it was over. Then the 619 landed, and I saw he wasn't really moving at all as I climbed those ropes. I never thought I'd hold the WWE Championship when I started. Getting that three count on Miz, holding that championship in my hands, it was an incredible moment in my career. If it didn't last as long as I would have hoped, no one can take that achievement away from me. And without someone like the Miz to push me in that bout, I truly wouldn't know if it would have meant as much as it did. After a short time away, I finally returned home to WWE and was looking to make an impact, and found myself in the crosshairs of the Samoan submission machine, Samoa Joe. I believe Samoa Joe is very dangerous in many qualities in this game. He's strong, he's fast, his submissions are incredible. I felt all of those three and more every time I faced him. Each time we met, it felt like he found a new body part to target.
Aside from being ruthless, Samoa Joe is one of the most intelligent competitors you will ever see inside of a ring.
Samoa Joe is relentless. And I'm man enough to admit that he got the best of me at WrestleMania.
If you thought what I did to you at WrestleMania was bad already, tonight we'll make that pale in comparison.
I wasn't gonna let him derail my WWE return so soon. With the chance to battle him again on Raw, I knew that if I could dig deep and avoid his devastating blows, I had a chance, which against Joe is all you can really ask for. Just do whatever he wanted of me. Look how he just tosses me out of the ring. But I was still okay. A little shook, but okay. That Tope never had a chance. I was just happy he didn't catch me there. Joe's a really strong dude, and I was risking being powerbombed on the floor if this didn't work. Definitely overestimated the damage I'd done to Joe at this point. He just waited for me to come to him, and I obliged. Huge, painful mistake right there. to get creative if I was going to win over Joe. I hit him with stuff that he hadn't seen me do before. Just like that. Never had someone just block the 619 before like that. Joe's lethal, and I had to act fast. Precision beats power, correct? Placed the boot perfectly and got myself a little time just to breathe. I didn't do something quick. This was gonna go like every other match I'd had with Joe. Really rocked, I'm not gonna lie. Luckily, he went to lift me up and not go for a cover right there. Joe had me where he wanted me, but he waited just a little too long to act, and that gave me the time to realize what was happening. I countered the Uranagi and finally get the pinfall victory over him.
Here is your winner.
I know the United States Championship wasn't on the line that night, but beating Samoa Joe that night made me feel like a real champion. Joe made me realize immediately in my return that WWE hadn't gone any easier, and I'd had to be on my A-game each and every night. He's an incredible opponent, and not too bad of a guy when he's not jumping you after you beat him for the U.S. Championship, I guess. Throughout my career, I competed against the best luchadors on the planet, and I owned victories over them all.
The greatest masked superstar in WWE history.
The chance to take on another Lucha Libre master in Gran Metalik was something that got me very excited. Competing against another luchador, it motivates me. It inspires me to learn from the new generation, and I have something to teach them as well. This guy right here, Gran Metalik, at one time, was watching me on TV and said, I want to do that. And look at him now, one of the best. He's the king of the ropes.
Metalik loves to fly.
It's a different style of high flying. It's a different control. this generation has something new under their sleeve. And you have to respect that.
The heritage and culture of Lucha Libre in great hands here.
When I had the opportunity to face Gran Metalik, I knew these were deep roots. We were going back to where I began. I was so excited to give the WWE Universe a taste of true lucha libre and knew this was a dream match that they couldn't afford to miss. Since I had returned, and man, he came out crisp, looking good, and on point. Counters everything I tried. Now I've given this move to many of my opponents and taken them down. But when I hit Metalik with this Rana and he pulled out with the cartwheel, I was like, now trust me, I have a lot of respect for Metalik. When I set him up with a 619, I said, is this match gonna be over that soon? As I ran and I go to hit it, he pulled out and then just rolled me up. One, two, kick out. I was like, wow, okay. I knew at the beginning of this that he was gonna bring a fight, but he really brought the fight. Senton, and right after that, it's the springboard crossbody. Two moves that always go back to back. This is the lucha libre style. That's what it's about. That's right. El Rey de las Sogas, king of the ropes, right? Hard to not be impressed when you see him do that, but not when you're on the receiving end. It's like everywhere we went, Gran Metalik was in my face, not backing down from anything. And that rana, man, I don't remember even being knocked out so hard off a rana. Normally it's me giving them, not taking them. I still had the fight with him, kicked out at two, but I had to stay sharp if I would leave with my hand raised. Gran Metalik wasn't letting up. When that frog splash landed, I knew that was it. It was over. Now, I gotta say, Gran Metalik put up a hell of a fight. He was everything I expected and much more to be as an opponent. And I told him once it was over, I would love to have this match once again. I love seeing the next wave of luchadores, and getting to test myself against one of the best and the upcoming was very special to me. Getting the win, of course, just makes it much sweeter. Rivalries in WWE often go beyond pride or championships and turn personal. With that said, I've never felt a more personal, bitter, and gruesome rivalry than I did with Seth Rollins. The Messiah and his disciple Murphy attacked my livelihood and targeted my eye. That particular attack was unexpected. Once they took that, they targeted my family and brutalized my son, Dominic. For months, our tense rivalry continued to escalate, and I knew it was coming to a head. I desperately wanted revenge. At payback, we were going to show Seth and Murphy that they picked on the wrong family to mess with, and we were going to return all the pain they'd put on us. And to my pride, Dominic was going to show me that he was more than capable of standing on his own. I was surprised as much as the WWE Universe with his ability to perform. Wrestling against Seth Rollins at SummerSlam for the first time, that was his first match ever. And he'd done moves he had never done before. Positioning, timing, that all takes years to learn. And he managed to pick up on it in one night, teaming with my son for the first time. I felt like I was flying higher than any West Coast pop. We were going to overwhelm them from the start. Nothing was going to stop the Mysterio family that night. Nothing.
That was dope. Him, his son. Oh, this hard.
Thank you.
all day, but I'd rather not.
Yeah.
was okay, then I was back in the match. But now, I was to do some work on Seth. Started in this game, there were a lot of doubts about what I'd be able to accomplish. From day one, I took that doubt and used it to fuel my desire to reach for the sky and achieve everything I could desire in this business. Whether that meant taking to the air against fellow luchadors and high flyers, or trying to outmaneuver the greatest mat technicians, or simply trying to avoid the biggest finishers from the biggest monsters. I was always ready to prove that I had the ability to not just be good, to not only become a champion, but to go down in history as one of the greatest superstars of all time. I've traveled the world in search of the highest competition, and while things didn't always go my way, I've made sure to try and turn every negative to a positive. When you have the entire world thinking you're in over your head, sometimes the best feeling in the world is reminding them that you're exactly where you're supposed to be. After spending over 30 years in sports entertainment, I still have the same hunger, the same desire to show people that doubt me that they're making a mistake. I still want to win championships, and I still want to compete at the highest level. I just have the added benefit of getting to watch my son now walk the roads that I traveled years before. He'll face those same doubts, and hopefully I've given him the tools to overcome and prove people wrong. As for me, the greatest mask of all time, well, let's just say that this old filthy animal still has plenty of tricks left up his sleeve. Plenty of 619s left to dial up, and plenty of lessons to teach the WWE superstars. I'm fortunate enough to say that I'm so proud of what I've done in the ring. Proud of who I've competed against, proud of who I've defeated, and proud of the records I've set. The love of the fans, the friendships I've made everywhere I've been, and the security sports entertainment has given my family, I couldn't have asked for anything more. It's no mystery that the love of the fans is what makes me truly feel like a king.
That was dope.